Well, good morning, church. We're so glad that you're here today. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. We're going to worship the Lord together today. So it's so important as we come into the house of the Lord, as the gathered assembly of God's people, that we publicly declare in faith the truths that we believe. And this has a way of just grounding us in Him and taking us back to the anchor of our faith. And as we set this hope before us, as we come to worship, Hebrews says we have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of our soul. So as we worship this morning, let's let this set our mind on Christ. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in life eternal, and I believe
that song, it says, you alone deserve the glory, the honor, and the praise. He alone is holy. He is worthy of all of our adoration. And we're going to sing a new song this morning. And it talks about God is holy forever. From the beginning of time, for all of eternity, he is holy. That is who he is. And as we sing this song, we are joining with the angels. We're joining with the heavenly choruses, attributing glory to God. Because that's who he is. He is holy forever. And so, as we sing this song, we get to reflect on who God is and give glory to his name.
Your name stands above them all.
take a seat. We're going to enter into a time of communion. We have a holy God who deserves all of our adorations. And one of the ways we get to reflect and worship him is through communion. So I invite our ushers forward to prepare the elements. And we have holy God, but we also have a God who came down. A God who invites us into relationship. And communion shows us that. Communion is being able to reflect on what Christ has done for us. The bread representing his body. The cup representing his blood. That we know through Christ we have access to a holy God who loves us. What a blessing that is. And as we have communion together, we remind each other as a family who we are in Christ. And so we're going to take some time this morning to reflect on what Christ has done for us as a family. And if you haven't accepted Christ as your Savior, this is a family meal. And so we ask you to let the elements pass by. But we're going to take some time to see some scriptures on the screen, and you'll be able to reflect on what Christ has done for us. So as you receive the elements, sit and reflect, and then we will take the elements all together in a couple of minutes after we've just taken time to sit and reflect on what Christ has done for us. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, they broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's receive it.
Yeah.
to the darkness you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, so we say, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath.
Every breath that we have has come from you. God,
We only have breath in our lungs because you gave it to us, Lord. God, and we stand in your house. For those of us who know you, God, we have been forgiven. God, we have been cleansed. We have been made new. God, and how could we not give you thanks? How could we not give you praise, Lord? So find us thankful, God. Find us grateful, God. Find us forever worshiping your name, Lord Jesus. Would your name be exalted in this place? You alone are worthy, God. You alone are worthy. Please be with us for the rest of our service, God. Our hearts are open. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can take a seat.
Well, good morning, Harvest. What a great day to worship the Lord together. Welcome. My name is John. I serve as one of the pastors here. And hey, if you are new to the church, maybe this is your first weekend, or maybe you've been here for a couple weeks, I would love to invite you to a small little reception taking place just after the service. It's going to be in the Hope Center. It's designed to discover Harvest. So for you to learn a little bit more about who Harvest is, to connect with those who might be newer to the church as well, and to help find out what your next step might be as you're exploring Harvest Bible Chapel. So maybe that'll be a help to you. If you've been here for any period of time, you know that we have an app, and I would encourage you to take that out and to check in today. But then if you've got something you'd love for us as a staff to be praying for, take a moment, fill in a prayer request. You can do that today. You can do it throughout the week. If you're looking for a group to get involved in, to live in a group, we've got ways for you to just connect through that app, and we would be delighted to get you connected to a group here at the church. Well, each week we pray for a local gospel church in the area that's doing much like what we're doing. We're praising the Lord, we're worshiping the Lord, but we're going to go out of our state today all the way over to Arizona where it's nice and sunny and beautiful out, and we're going to be praying for Christ Church and Pastor Adam Bailey, and they have been... They were a church plant out of Chicago, Harvest, and they are preaching the gospel every week. And one of the things that Adam asked us to be praying for is that we would be praying for a conference they're having for church leaders and pastors. It's taking place over these next couple days. Also to be praying for, we mentioned it a couple months ago, they have City Hope, and it's much like our Hope Center, and they're expanding that in their downtown Phoenix location. They're putting a 5,000 square foot addition on so that they might be able to reach and care for the people in the community in an even greater way. So we're going to pray for them in a moment, but those are two specific things you can be praying for, Christ Church this week and Pastor Adam. And as we continue in worship, we always want to make sure that as we are thinking about giving, that we're clear in our communication. And so we've got a little financial update that you'll see on the screen.
Hi, everybody. Jeff Bucknam, Jeff Lucido, on behalf of Jeff Sharda, with Jeff Cox doing some filming. It's the Jeff Show. Hey, we are here to communicate a couple things regarding some of the financial situations around the church. We decided last year that we were going to be a little bit more regular in those updates this year. Last year, we often wait till the end of the year, as most ministries do, to communicate that kind of thing. But this year, we thought, well, why don't we do it every couple months? And so here we are, kind of in the February, you know, mid-February kind of time frame. And so we thought, okay, we'll just give you an update regarding how the finances and stuff are going and what kinds of things that are required here. So first, thank you so much for your continued commitment to Harvest. It's amazing at the end of every year how God comes through his people. So awesome. As far as this year, starting off, usually churches are a little slow, but we've been like that as well. But we have some needs this year that are a little bit more than last year.
Yeah.
You decided to raise all the budgets because you, why?
We ended up raising the top line budget 6% for 2024, and that is for a variety of reasons. The main reason is we partnered with CFR last year, as many of you heard, and they were generous to allow us to pay interest only for the first year. So we weren't making any principal payments, but this year we are gonna make almost $1 million of principal payments.
Which is a good thing.
It's a good thing, right, we're paying down debt. But it's $1 million more.
It is. Yeah.
So that was one thing, but we didn't want it to just be about that because we're a church. So we also have some things we're doing with ministry.
Yeah.
And there's also things with, there's a lot of employees. I don't know how many employees there are.
There's a lot of employees. One of the challenges that we've had in the last little while is that we've not been able to make any kind of like market adjustment updates, that kind of thing. And so when we look back across the different employees and stuff, we said, oh, this person's not being paid according to the market these days. And so we said, look, it, regardless of what it costs or that kind of thing, we said, look, we need to actually update those, just like in your business. That would be the kind of thing that you'd think would be the right thing to do, and we certainly feel the same way. As far as the ministries, though, part of the first kind of foray into this was that so we didn't have any money actually for the ministries because we were trying to cut so much. We ended up getting to the point where we were so paltry, but you guys weren't happy about that on our finance committee.
Yeah, I mean, we think that people want to be a part of a church that, yes, is prudent with their finances, but also acts in faith to do really cool things in our community. So we worked on a solution where we came up with ideas for how we could do ministry in different quarterly chunks. And as the Lord provides, according to the budget we have set, we have more ministry opportunity. Yeah. And so
we make decisions every quarter, depending on how that quarter went. And we're praying that the Lord would provide each quarter so that we can kind of keep on the same path. And so that's why we're here. That's why I'm gonna just let you in on all of that kind of information and pray that the Lord would actually move in all of our hearts to be generous, as we know He would like to be. You know, I'm always reminded of George Mueller, who you've heard me talk about before. He was a guy who actually raised a whole bunch of money without really asking too much for it. He just let people know what the ministry was about, and he had all sorts of orphanages all over England that were constantly supplied by God's amazing grace. And we believe that's going to be the case for Harvest. Some really cool, exciting things in our future. Church planting and leadership development and partnerships beyond in Chicago and beyond, and we are really excited about seeing this. We'd love to see more money freed up so that we can make all of that kind of stuff happen. So thanks so much for listening. Jeff, on behalf of Jeff, for Jeff, and another Jeff. See ya.
That's great. Well, to continue with the Jeff theme, there's a podcast that comes out today. It's called Conversations with Jeff Bucknum. And so that hits today. If you want to learn even more about some of the finances of what's going on behind the scenes and how you can be a part of what's going on, that comes out today. Wherever you download podcasts, would encourage you to take a listen. Well, every week in our worship, we are reminded with on the screen different ways that we can give. But the Lord cares about our heart. And in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, it says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart may be also." And so why don't we just commit this time to the Lord and asking for Him to do His work in our heart, that we might be able to see His work continue forward and through our generosity. And so, Father, thank You for this day. We worship You and adore You. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and You know our very needs, and You know our very desires of how we want to spread the gospel. I'm thankful for Pastor Adam and for his bold proclamation of the truth, and would You bless him today? Would You use his church in that Phoenix area to reach some of the needy that are in need of hope, in need of Your gospel? And I pray that You would just bless their efforts as they add on to the building, as they pour into pastors and church leaders. Would You give them wisdom as they lead that? And Father, thank You for the chance we have right now to give to You. Thank You for our church and for what You are going to do through these funds that come in today and this week. Would You have Your way, Father? We love You and adore You, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, before we get into God's word, we finish up the book of Ecclesiastes today. I'd love to invite you to stand to your feet and introduce yourself to someone that you might not already know.
Church. Hey. Oh, it's good to see you. My name is not Jeff, just in case you were wondering. My name's Tommy Creutz. I serve as the campus pastor of our Crystal Lake campus, but also on our preaching team. We get the great pleasure of bringing God's word to us. And you're going to need your Bible today. We're going to be in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12. This is actually our last message in our study of the book of Ecclesiastes. Next week, we're going to be jumping into the parables of the kingdom as we lead up into Easter. So you need your Bible. Get your eyes on a Bible. If you don't have one, there's one under the seat in front of you. We'd love for you to grab that. Open up to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. We're actually going to be going through the entirety of the chapter today. And as you're turning to that, has anyone ever seen this acronym? That might not be clear because that looks like a J, but that's a semicolon. You know what? Let's start over. Better? I can't write a semicolon. That's a semicolon. TLDR. Have you heard of that acronym before? Does anyone know what that means? No one? Too long, didn't read. Oh, yes. Too long, didn't read. And this it has a couple of meanings. One of the things that it's used for is that when someone maybe is arguing with someone else and they maybe text back just a giant text, like a book of an argument, the quick-witted response back to them would be TLDR, too long, didn't read. I'm not going to take the time to read that long argument. Are you kidding me? No way, right? But the meaning of that is morphed. It's changed over time. It's been added to. And what people would use this acronym for would be, hey, here's this really long article, but TLDR, if you don't have a lot of time, just read this part of it. And it's going to give you a bit of the facts, a little bit of a summary of what it's all about so that you can really get the gist of the article or the argument. And then later on, it's evolved even more to where now, at the bottom of almost all articles, you'll see this, or a lot of articles at least. They'll have their long format article, their body of work, and then at the end it'll be TLDR. And what they'll give is a brief summary of what it is that they have discussed in the article and the conclusions that they came to. That's TLDR. And we're going to see an ancient version of that in our time today in God's word. We're going to see a little ancient TLDR in Ecclesiastes chapter 12. The title of our time is The End of the Matter. The End of the Matter. We've gone through this study in Ecclesiastes for the past couple of months, in which we have met this person named the preacher, or Kohelet. And Kohelet really is a person who has attained all of the things that life has to offer. He's kind of at the pinnacle of life. He has all of the things, power, money, wealth, success, favor. He has all that life has to offer. And he looks out across mankind. He uses this phrase, under the sun. He looks at life of mankind under the sun, and he comes to this conclusion that the pursuits of man, that life is full of, if you have the ESV, it says vanity. If you have the NIV, it says it's meaningless. But the word there is hevel. It's the Hebrew word, and it literally means breath. It's used 38 times in the book of Ecclesiastes. It means breath. And it really is this idea of chasing after the wind. You can't really grab onto it. It's unfulfilling. It's unsatisfying. It is fleeting. It's like vapor. Smoke, it's there one moment and gone the next. It is unpredictable. It is, in some ways, meaningless. And he also uses the phrase under the sun about 27 times throughout the book. And what that's referring to is this life here and now. What is life like here on earth right now? Not really considering eternity. What is life like now? And as we read through the book of Ecclesiastes, as we've studied through it, maybe this question has kind of been mulling around in your head of like, and for the people too. And really the question that Kohelet is answering is, what meaning can we find in this life if this life is all there is? What meaning can we find in life if this life is all that there is? And there's plenty of people in our world who believe this, right? That this life is it. So I need to pursue power and wealth and favor and position to give my life meaning, to give my life satisfaction, to be fulfilled. These are the things that I need to get, and I chase and I chase and I chase. And Kohelet, as he looks over that, he says that it's all hevel. meaningless, vapor, chasing after the wind. So another question comes out of that. What meaning can we find in this life if this life isn't all that there is? What meaning can we find in this life isn't all that there is? If there is something beyond this life, if there is something after this life, what should we be going after? What should we be pursuing? What's not hevel? To use the language of the scripture, what is the duty of mankind? Well, we're gonna get that answer today in our time in God's word, but we're not gonna start there. We're not gonna start with the answer. We're gonna work up to it. We're gonna get there. First, we're gonna start with some good things that we should be doing. And here's the first thing. It's to remember God, because life is fleeting. Remember God, life is fleeting. Remember also your creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days. This is probably better translated as sad days. It's not morally evil days. Before the sad days come and the years draw near, of which you will say, I have no pleasure in them. Before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain. So right before this in chapter 11, Kohelet in verse 9, he says to the young man, rejoice. Rejoice in your youth and let your heart cheer you in the days of your youth. Walk in the ways of your heart and the sight of your eyes, but know that for these things, God will bring you into judgment. So he says, rejoice in your youth. Rejoice, have joy in your heart, but let your joy in your heart and your eyes be controlled by the knowledge of God's judgment. So rejoice, but remember also your creator. Remember also your creator in the days of your youth. To remember the creator is to know God and thus to follow his paths of wisdom and therefore extend the joys of life. Because if we forget God, if we don't remember God, the sad, evil days will come. The hardship comes. The difficult providence comes. The years go by and rob your joy. It says the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain. This is the loss of joy. The joy is darkened. And when the storm comes, there isn't the joy of the sunlight after the storm, only more clouds. And when we forget our creator, that capacity for joy will be lost. So we remember our creator so that we can extend the joys of our life, because life is fleeting. In fact, Kohelet is gonna describe that right here. He's gonna use some poetic language to describe the aging process. And maybe you've read through this before and you're like, really? That's what he's doing here? It is, yeah. So before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain, in the day when the keepers of the house tremble. This is poetic language for our hands. The keepers of the house, things that put things where they need to be in our house. They, in our old age, as we age, they start to tremble. It says, and the strong men are bent. This is referring to the prominent strong muscle groups, right? Back, legs, right? As we age, they deteriorate. And the grinders cease because they are few. What do you think the grinders is referring to? Teeth. They cease because they are few. They stop working because they start to fall out, right? Oh, old age. What a poetic way to say that. And those who look through the windows are dimmed. It's referring to the eyes dimming as we grow older. And the doors on the street are shut when the sound of the grinding is low. And one rises up at the sound of a bird and all the daughters of song are brought low. That door on the street being shut, it's our ears ceasing to work, not being able to hear so well. My wife accuses me of this all the time. I always respond with, huh? She's like, you're getting older, right? The sound of the grinding is low. The daughters of song are brought low. But it's this paradox that he's also putting into play here, is that yes, while we're losing our hearing in our old age, one rises up at the sound of a bird when they chirp early in the morning. We hear that and we wake up at 4 a.m., right? They are afraid also of what is high, and the terrors are in the way. This is a reminder of the frailty of our body as we remember that. Man, back when I was young, I could jump off of this stage, wouldn't be no problem. If I did it now, I'd break every bone in my body, right? We're afraid of also what is high, and the terrors are in the way. The almond tree blossoms. Anyone know what the flower of the almond tree, what color it is? It's white. It's referring to the hair. Turns white. The grasshopper drags itself along. What once used to be so light in this body, used to be able to jump and run and not feel my body at all, but now in these days I am feeling the aches and the pains and the sore joints, and the grasshopper drags itself along, and desire fails, right? This is speaking of sexual desire, fails. Because man is going to his eternal home. The body is decaying. It is frail. The aging process is happening. And then the mourners go about the streets. And then we get some images of death before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. And dust returns to the earth as it was. This is a reference back to Genesis. We came from dust. We will return as dust, and the spirit returns to God who gave it, who is in control of all life. All of these things described in the aging process are reminders for us that our body is going to its eternal home. I actually just got this reminder in the past few years. I'm 35 now, so I've just started my journey of the aging process, just at the precipice. Some of you who are older are like, you have no idea what's in store. I don't. But I did. Here's one thing that did happen that maybe you'll find funny, is that I was reaching for a shirt in my closet and I threw out my back. How did that happen? I have no idea. Or sometimes I'll be sitting for too long and I'll try to get up and my knees are like, no, no, you're staying right there. You're not getting up at all. And every sore joint, every pain, every ache, every pulled muscle, the loss of eyesight, every graying hair that you see is a reminder that this life is fleeting, that your body is going to its eternal home, that your physical body is deteriorating. Life is fleeting. So there's really two implications here in the text for us. The first is the very literal. Remember your creator in the days of your youth. Remember your creator in the days of your youth. Know God at an early age. And I've given over a decade of my life to pastoring students. And it was a joy to help them, young men and women, to know God and to follow in his ways according to his word. And I wanted to help them. I wanted to help them know who God was, so that one, they would have eternity with Christ forever, but also so that they would walk in paths of wisdom throughout the rest of their days, so that the joys of their life would be extended, as the scripture tells us. I wanted them to know that. And I've come across many students who listened to that and did exactly that. But I've also come across a lot of young men and women who would say something to the effect of, I want to live my life the way that I want to live it. I don't want to remember my creator while I'm young. I want to go and live however I see fit to live. I want to be out of the rule of my parents and out of the rule of God over my life. And I want to decide, and I want to go after these things. And then after I'm done living my life, then I'll come and I'll remember God. I've heard that more times than I could possibly count. There's two problems with that line of thinking. Maybe you're in here right now and you're young and you've thought that, or you believe that right now. I'll remember God later. Two problems is you're not promised tomorrow. A man does not know the number of his days. You're not promised tomorrow, next week, the next month. Tragedy could befall you in a moment. So remember your creator and your youth as soon as you can. The other problem with that is that you're falling for the bait. You're taking the cheese in the trap. The world promises joy and happiness and pleasure from these things. And you might receive that for a moment, sure, but it is fleeting. It's hevel. It's a lie. You will not get what you think you will. And instead, you will get sorrow and grief and regret. There's so many people probably in this room who have come to Christ later on in life. I've talked to so many who have done exactly that, who have made a decision for Christ later on in their life. And the one thing that they always say, I wish that I would have followed God sooner. I wish that I would have followed him when I was younger. That would have kept me away from all of the stupid decisions that I made, falling into that temptation of sin, that regretful thing that I did, that thing that still to this day brings me sadness. I would have avoided that because I would have been walking in the ways of his wisdom. They wish they knew him sooner. So remember your Creator. Know God and follow him now. The other implication is, I heard this quote, hopefully you'll resonate with it if you're a little older, is that you're still young. You're not dead. You're still young, all right? And so I don't care how old you are, you're not dead. The aging process hasn't completely claimed you. You haven't gone to your eternal home yet. So remember your Creator. And walk in his way and extend the joys of life and have a hope for that eternal home with Christ forever. Do that today. Remember your Creator. Life is fleeting. Here's the second thing is practice wisdom because life is vanity. Practice wisdom because life is vanity. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher. All is vanity. This is this might look familiar. This is a bookend to chapter 1, verse 2, where the preacher says this exact thing. He starts the book of Ecclesiastes with this, and he ends the book of Ecclesiastes with this. Hevel of hevels, says the preacher. All is hevel. All of it. All is hevel. So practice wisdom. Goes on and says, besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. Did you notice the narrator shift in that verse right there? Before it was the preacher saying these things, and now these things are being said of the preacher. Someone talking about the preacher. This is a brief biography at the end of the book about the preacher, and we find out that he is, in fact, wise. If that wasn't apparent already to us. And we see that he taught people knowledge and weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. A weighing means that he carefully evaluated the subject at hand, that he was cautious and balanced in his approach with what he was handling. He studied. He was thorough in looking into life under the sun. He looked at all of it. He was thorough. And he arranged many proverbs with great care. He was thoughtful of the orderliness of how this was presented so that we would hear the wisdom of it. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. Another look into the preacher's character, that he sought to find words of delight, pleasant words, nice words, right? And he wrote the words of truth. And these speak to his balance in being pleasant and also upright. There's a quote, to be upright without being pleasant is to be a fool. To be pleasant without being upright is to be a charlatan. So Kohelet wisely found the balance between those things, and he balanced pleasantness and uprightness, speaking the truth. He goes on, the words of the wise are like goads and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. Goad would be a long, pointy stick that shepherds would use to poke and prod their livestock to go in a specific, certain direction, right? Whoa, 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 there's a cliff over there. Don't go there. Poke, poke, poke. Go this way. Poke, prod, poke. Go that way. Right? No, no, no. There's a thorny bush over there. Poke, poke, poke. Go in the right path. Go in the right direction. Right? There's danger over there. Don't go there. Poke, poke, poke. Go in the right direction. The words of wisdom are like goads, poking and prodding us to go in the right direction, to go in the right path. Parents, we do this with our kids all the time, right? When you're like walking through someplace and you're trying to help them know where they're supposed to be going, because I've known this, maybe it's just my children, but maybe all children everywhere have a terrible sense of like personal bubbles with people, and they'll run into people as they're walking, and like they just have no concept of danger either. This is why we'll never go to the Grand Canyon anyway. Is that while you're walking with them, you're poking and prodding and moving and hey, nope, this way, nope, this way, nope, this way. Let's avoid that, that's a pothole, get away from that, right? We try and goad them into the right path. And wisdom from above, God's wisdom, pokes and prods us in the ways of righteousness. Psalm 23 says he leads us on the paths of righteousness, right? And those who practice wisdom, they are led into paths of righteousness because they listen to the wisdom. They're led into paths of righteousness. The nails, like nails firmly fixed, are the collected sayings. This means that they are sturdy, that they are not going to be moved. Unmoving truth, no matter the times or the seasons, its truth remains fixed. Like a nail, firmly fixed are the collected sayings. And they're given by one shepherd. Who's that one shepherd? God. This is a reference to God. He is the one shepherd who pokes and prods us on the paths of wisdom, who gives us these unmovable truths, no matter the times and seasons. His truth remains fixed. He then gives a warning, my son, beware of anything beyond these. Beware of anything outside the wisdom of God. Beware of anything outside the wisdom of God. Of making many books, there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. There's so many books about every topic, but be careful. Be careful to go outside of the wisdom of God. Beware of anything beyond these wise things of the Lord. Practice wisdom. This is wisdom literature, after all. It's one of the books of wisdom in the Bible. We have Job, we have Psalms, we have Proverbs, we have Ecclesiastes, and we have the Song of Solomon or the Song of Songs. And the purpose of these books is to help us to live wisely. Life is full of hevel, so let's live wisely. We talked about that at length last week. So how do we practically practice wisdom? The wisdom that is from above, the type of wisdom that Qohelet is practicing. Well, first, I think we have to ask the question of where does it come from? Where does this wisdom come from? Does it come from a book? Does it come from just other people? For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Wisdom comes from the Lord, comes from his mouth. And what comes out of the mouth? His words. And we have right here his word, right? So wisdom comes from the Lord, comes from his word, from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. We can understand the Lord through his word. Okay, we have his word. So where do we begin with wisdom then? How does wisdom begin? Well, Proverbs 9 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Having a genuine reverence and respect for the Lord. It's to know his absolute greatness and power and justice. That's the fear of the Lord. It's not I'm afraid. It's a reverent awe, respect, knowing his greatness and power and justice. Fearing the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And how do we get this wisdom when we fear the Lord? Well, James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. If you lack wisdom, ask God to give you wisdom. Pray. Lord, I really need, the situation has come up and I don't know how to handle it. I've got this worldly wisdom that maybe tells me to do it this way, and a couple of friends have told me this way, but God, in your wisdom, what should I do? How do I act wisely here? How do I live wisely in this moment? If you lack wisdom, ask God. Every time that you open the scriptures to read his word, to understand more about him and his ways and his paths and his wisdom, you should pray. God, would you give me wisdom to understand your word? Would you give me wisdom to be able to not only know it in my mind, but then live it out through my life? If we lack wisdom, we can ask God who gives to us. And what is this wisdom like? Well, James 3:17 says, but the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. That's what this wisdom is like. It's pure, peaceable, gentle, not harsh, open to reason, full of mercy, good fruits, impartial and sincere. So then the question is, well, what are the benefits of this wisdom? What's the advantage of this type of wisdom, this wisdom from above? Back to Proverbs. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, and in her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called blessed. Life is hevel. Let's pursue wisdom, amen? Here's the last thing, is to fear God. Fear God, justice is coming. Fear God, justice is coming. Verse 13, the end of the matter. All has been heard. Here it is. At the end of the book, the end of the matter, there's nothing further coming in these writings from Qohelet the preacher. This is the end of the matter. All has been heard. All of the evidence is in. All of the searching, all of the looking at life under the sun. This is the conclusion of all of it. What should we do? We fear God. And we keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. You're like, man, that seems simple. All of that to say that, yeah. All of the evidence has come in. The end of the matter is this. Fear God and keep his commandments. The TLDR, the summary, the conclusion of this body of work. Fear God. Have a reverent respect of God and his unchanging power and justice. Understand his greatness and understand my position in comparison to him. I'm small and he is great. And keep his commandments. Walk according to his word. Obey him. For this is the whole duty of man. The wisest thing that you can do with your life is to fear God and to keep his commandments. This life finds meaning with a life lived in dependence and obedience to God. And when we understand that we aren't living for the things of this world, that this world in fact is just full of hevel, but instead we are living for an eternity with God, where we will finally experience true satisfaction and true fulfillment and true joy and purpose. All of the things that people look for in this world, all the things that people look for here in this world, in this life, is not found in this life. It's found in the life to come. So when we live a life for God, We focus our eyes on the eternal perspective. When we fear God and we keep his commandments, we are living for eternity, focused on that eternal perspective. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. The book ends with a little bit of a warning. Verse 14 says, "For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil." This is echoed in the New Testament, 2 Corinthians 5:10. This is Paul. He says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ." Who? All. Just some people? Everyone. "We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil." Now, this is a pretty uncomfortable verse in our day and age, right? Because we live in a society that is quite literally allergic to accountability, right? Have you noticed that? Like, we're allergic to it. Like, oh, accountability? Oh, no thanks. It messes up my stomach. So just none of that, please. Or, I'm not gonna have any accountability today. I get a rash when I have it. I'm allergic, right? We see people all over the place trying to dodge accountability left and right and left and right, and they lie and they try to keep it secret. They try to hide it from their boss. They try to hide it from their spouse. They try to hide it from people. They don't want the accountability for their, well, specifically their bad actions, right? Plenty of people want accountability for their good deeds, right? I did that. Yeah, that was me. I did that. Notice me. Amazing. But not for the bad ones, not for the evil. No one wants accountability for that, right? We avoid it. We try to dodge it. We try to keep it secret. And you might get around it with your boss. You might be able to keep it secret from him or her. You might be able to keep it a secret from your spouse. You might be able to keep it a secret from your kids. You might get around it with other people in your life. But listen to me. Listen to God's word. You will never get around it with God. Everyone will come to the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for what they have done, whether good or evil. This is God's perfect justice, his perfect holy justice. So what that means is that what we do in this life really matters. It really matters because it is going before a holy God who is going to judge our deeds, good and evil. One day God will clear the heaven and bring his justice on all that we have done. So fear the Lord and keep his commandments. A little theological reflection on Christ real quick, because there's good news in this. The good news is that for the believer, the one who has put their faith and trust in Christ alone for the forgiveness of their sin, for their salvation, when they stand before the judgment of God, they are forgiven. We have been given Christ's righteousness because of what he has done, not because of what we have done or our deeds, good or evil, but because of what Christ has done. Living the perfect life, dying the death that you and I deserve to die because of our sin against a holy God who died and was raised to life 3 days later and ascended into heaven, sit at the right hand of God. When we put our faith and trust in him, we are considered not guilty, free in Christ, forgiven in Christ. That's the good news for the Christian. Now, that should not throw us deeper into, I'll just live however I want because I'll be forgiven in the end, right? No. It should push us deeper and deeper and deeper into fearing God and keeping his commandments out of our love and appreciation for all that Christ has done for us. The end of the matter is this. Fear God and keep his commandments. For only in God do we find the ultimate meaning of this life, that everything you have been searching for is found in him. I want to end with a Charles Spurgeon quote, because of course he put it great. He says, when thou really knowest God, thou shalt be thrice happy. If thou dost run toward him, falling down before him, worshiping him with bowed head yet glad heart, all the while fearing toward him and not away from him. Blessed is the man whose heart is filled with that holy fear, which inclines his steps in the way of God's commandments, inclines his heart to seek after God, and inclines his whole soul to enter into fellowship with God, that he may be acquainted with him and be at peace. Fear God and keep his commandments. It's the end of the matter. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your wisdom, for your word. We are so thankful that you have given your word to us. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we would do exactly as your word says, that we would fear you and follow your commandments, that we would obey you because we love you. In you, we find ultimate meaning in this life. Everything that we search for, everything that we have been trying to pursue in this world, to satisfy us, to give us joy, to bring us fulfillment, everything is perfectly found in you. Would you help us to know more, to know that more and more and more, that what we do in this life really does matter, and that we cannot keep any secret from you, Lord. That all of our deeds, good and evil, will come before you. And we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, who rose again, defeating sin and death so that we can be reconciled to God. Lord, let us not forget these truths. Let us walk in wisdom. Let us remember you. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
And let that let's stand and respond. Forsaken, you are one true love.
Jesus. We're coming back, coming back to you.
Book of Ecclesiastes, putting some things in perspective. And I don't know how you came in here this morning. Maybe you are passionately pursuing Jesus with everything you have, or maybe there's been some distractions along the way. You can come back to Jesus. Jesus will receive you just as you are, and he wants to restore that relationship. And so maybe you're in a place that's a place of difficulty. We're gonna have some folks down front to pray with you. Maybe you're in a place where you're like, I just need some answers to life's questions. Why don't you come down front and just pray with somebody and just bring those requests before the Lord. So don't run off today. Look for ways that you can lean into what the Lord is doing. And maybe it's by connecting with some other people here after church and just finding out what you can do to minister to one another. Maybe it's when you go outside in the lobby, you'll see that we can serve in our sweet spot. We want to be able to use our gifts and our talents for Christ. And so as we go out on mission this week, we take this message of hope that we've received and we share it with those who are in need. Let's do it with everything we have. And as we do that, know that we are going out with this on our hearts, that you are loved by the Lord. Have a great week.